All right, let's go deeper into the mitochondria piece. Talk about what they are, where they are, and then specifically what happens when they become overwhelmed and they start to break.
Mitochondria are these tiny things in our cells that most people know of as kind of the powerhouse of the cell. And what that means is that they take food and oxygen and convert it into energy. It's in the form of ATP, which is kind of the energy currency of a cell. So that's kind of the high school version of mitochondria, high school biology class. They're powerhouses of the cell. They take food and oxygen and turn it into ATP. There is no doubt that they do that, but in fact, they do so, so much more. Mitochondria are actually enormously complicated. They were actually foundational to the beginning of multicellular life, eukaryotic life, which is essentially all of the life forms that we can see with our eyes, plants, animals, other things. Any living thing that you can see with your eyes is a multicellular living organism, and its existence really depended on mitochondria at one point or another. So what else do mitochondria do? Mitochondria do so much more. So they actually control the synthesis of stress hormones, cortisol, estrogen, testosterone, other kinds of hormones. They help regulate neurotransmitter production and release and regulation. They help control inflammation, turning it both on and off. They help control the expression of genes from the cell nucleus. So they are epigenetic regulators. I could go on and on with their list of functions. So they do all of these things. And when mitochondria are producing energy, when they are revved up, the process by which they make ATP involves the flow of electrons. And these electrons are actually, you can think about them kind of like, you know, like an acidic kind of thing that's kind of, if it gets out of where it's supposed, if it leaks out, it could be a little damaging. And that is exactly what happens. When these electrons leak out of the usual process, it creates what's called reactive oxygen species. And these ROS, and this is oxidative stress. And this is what all the antioxidants are all the rage for, vitamin C, vitamin E, other blueberries. Everybody says, get your antioxidants. Why do you want antioxidants? It's to mitigate this oxidative stress. And so when mitochondria are being hyperstimulated, in the example of a traumatic or stressful situation, again, if it goes on for a prolonged period of time, when it's short-lived, the system is great. The system is highly regulated. It's highly adaptive. It helps us survive. It helps us fight and flee. It helps us do everything we need to do. So I'm not at all dissing the system. The system helps us survive. But when it goes on for a prolonged period of time, the mitochondria are just churning, churning, churning. Electrons begin to leak. That creates oxidative stress. And that means that oxidative stress, because they're right there, they're the first kind of victim of high levels of oxidative stress. That oxidative stress, or acid, if you think of it that way, can actually begin to damage the mitochondria themselves. It can also damage other parts of the cell. So high levels of oxidative stress can damage any part of the cell if it gets far enough. But again, because it's being produced right there, mitochondria are most vulnerable to that effect. And then if they become damaged, then the cell can become dysregulated, if you will. The cell can become damaged, if you will, in that insofar as some of its parts, the mitochondria, are now damaged. And this is a term usually called mitochondrial dysfunction. And so I know that's a lot of cell biology, and I know it probably sounds like really pointless, trivial stuff and crap, but just understanding that alone will help us develop better treatments for mental illnesses, all the way from mild anxiety, ADHD, depression, to crippling schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and other disorders.
Okay, just to make sure I have this right, mitochondria become overwhelmed. They create this ROS, which damages themselves. I just want to make the connection between the trauma and the breaking of the mitochondria. How are those specifically connected, or do we know at this point?
We do know. So again, when you have high levels of trauma, you get high levels of cortisol. And we know that cortisol alone, so like researchers just recently in the last couple of years did some studies where they put mitochondria in a petri dish. And they just saw them churning out ATP, doing their thing, going along. And they squirted a little bit of cortisol in, and they started hyper-producing ATP. So it means that you're revving up the engine. The cortisol is revving up the engine. And again, we want that. This is a good thing because it gives us energy to fight and flee. And it will stimulate processes that then result in higher levels of glucose, so that because we need that glucose to go run. We need to run from whoever is traumatizing us. And so we need that glucose. We need the higher heart rate. We need the higher blood pressure. These are all good adaptive things in the moment. But when it goes on for a prolonged period of time, that's where this reactive oxygen species comes in. Now you're hyper-stimulating these mitochondria. They're running on overtime. They're trying their best to keep up. But electrons start leaking out. They're still being told, keep going, don't slow down, don't recover, don't try to repair yourselves, don't stop. We're fighting for our life. We are fighting for our life. You've got to keep going, keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing. And the mitochondria are doing their thing. They're trying to save our lives. they're trying to do their share. But they start getting exhausted, so to speak, if you will. Like, I forgive the, you know, the scientists will recoil at these kind of analogies and euphemisms and other things I'm using, but I'm trying to make this understandable, and that is really understandable. Think of mitochondria as an engine. You're revving the engine. You're revving it too hard. You're pushing it too hard. You're not giving it a chance to recover. You're not giving it a chance to cool down. And acid starts leaking out. And now the acid is now damaging the very engine that's trying to save your life. And that is, again, when it comes to mitochondria, we can loosely refer to it as mitochondrial dysfunction. And now the very engines that are trying to save us, trying to give us enough energy to fight for our lives, are becoming damaged and dysregulated.
Okay, we're going to eventually connect this to the brain. But just to recap what you said there, I finally have the connection. We have the trauma, cortisol leads to the overactive mitochondria, ROS damaging the mitochondria. So that's the trauma piece. But let's talk about some of the other pillars that lead to this damage to the mitochondria. And then again, we'll move into what that means in the brain.
Okay. The unfortunate news is that there are lots of biological, psychological, and social factors that play a role in mitochondrial function or metabolism. So some of the basic ones are diet or nutrition, but this includes vitamin deficiencies, nutrient deficiencies, because mitochondria need a lot of the vitamins and nutrients that we've heard of are actually critical to mitochondrial function. It's actually mind-boggling how much of what we consume flows through mitochondria. The calories that we're consuming are all flowing for the most part. Most of them, I shouldn't say all, most of them are flowing through mitochondria. So that means all the different nutrients, the carbohydrates, the protein, the fats, they're flowing through mitochondria. But a lot of the vitamins, vitamin B12, folate, other things are required. They are required for mitochondrial function. Exercise directly impacts mitochondrial function. Sleep directly impacts mitochondrial function. Sleep does a lot more than that. And obviously, all of these things do more than just specific to mitochondria. But mitochondria are actually kind of the unifying link of biological, psychological, and social factors. Light exposure, circadian rhythms, drug and alcohol use, toxin exposure, whether it's microplastics, whether it's arsenic or cyanide, all of these are mitochondrial toxins. And so a wide range of things, infections. It's probably important to mention infections because that gets into like, how would long COVID cause a mental illness? A lot of people would think, well, that has nothing to do with metabolism. And what I would say is that it has everything to do with metabolism. That the infection itself is causing mitochondrial dysfunction. And that is why people, that's why some people who don't get the mitochondrial dysfunction can fight off an infection and live happily ever after and never have any serious symptoms of a mental illness. But people who maybe are vulnerable, maybe because of childhood trauma or a poor diet or some other things, people who are vulnerable, they get an infection with COVID, for example, and they might get pushed over the edge. They might get pushed over the edge with mitochondrial dysfunction because their mitochondria were kind of a little vulnerable anyway. And now there's yet another assault on them. And that pushes people over the edge. And then unfortunately, even after you've fought off the virus, you may have symptoms for months or sometimes years later. We kind of talked about stress, trauma. There are lots of other psychological, social factors that influence it. But the easiest way to think about most of the psychological and social factors is through stress pathways and trauma pathways. That they all converge in that way. But it's all of the usual things. So if you're being bullied and teased relentlessly on the playground, yes, that's stress or trauma. If you're lonely, nobody pays attention to you. That is traumatic or stressful for a lot of people. And on and on and on. So, yeah.
Okay, I can see how stress, trauma acts on the mitochondria. You brought in nutrient deficiencies and how we need certain nutrients for those to work properly. When it comes to the other factors, how many of those relate to the ROS and the damaging of the mitochondria that way?
You know, ultimately, that's a good question. I think most of the scientists who think about mitochondrial dysfunction think about it in terms of ROS and oxidative stress. But in fact, as I said earlier, mitochondria are extraordinarily complicated. And they do so much more than just create energy. And they do so much more than just flow electrons. They actually are going around cells and, again, they are one of the primary regulators of calcium in cells, for example. And that's a really important cell signal. They're primary regulators of inflammation. They are regulating gene expression. And all of those things are happening through a lot of complex different mechanisms and pathways. Mitochondria, fascinatingly, mitochondria can change their shape. You know, usually when you see them as a little oval, like a bean-shaped organelle or something. And but they actually can become like long strings almost. They can fuse with each other. They can actually form complex networks, take different shapes and stuff. And although that may seem random, shockingly, the different shapes that they take at different times during cell development actually directly influence which genes get expressed. And that ultimately influences what that cell becomes. So mitochondria play a role in neurodevelopment, is what I'm saying, and development of other cells, all cells. But they are playing a... So we know that all those factors, those biopsychosocial factors, are influencing mitochondria. We know that they are influencing metabolism and mental health. But the precise mechanisms, like is it all ROS? We really actually don't know. And I suspect it is not at all as simple as just ROS. That it's actually probably some of these other complex mechanisms. That like when you do this to mitochondria, it changes the gene expression in the cell. And when you do that to mitochondria, it does something different. At the end of the day, there's this like big complicated black box, so to speak. Like, okay, so you're saying biopsychosocial affects metabolism and mitochondria, and that's kind of this complicated black box in a way, if you will. We actually don't need to know the details of that complicated black box because the solutions don't require us to understand the details of that. The solutions sometimes, again, can be counterintuitive, can be paradoxical even, but the solutions can help people heal and recover. And we can help people reset their mitochondrial health or reset their metabolic health by some basic strategies. And that can help people with mental illnesses.
If you enjoyed that clip, you're going to want to head over here and catch the full episode. I'll see you over there.
There is zero doubt in my mind as a clinician who works with people with treatment-resistant mental illnesses that ketogenic diets can be life-changing for some people. The very first signs of Parkinson's disease.